Hello, everybody. Hello, and welcome to today's Flipgrid Live Event. I'm Anne from Team Flipgrid, and I am so excited today. We are welcoming Simone, a park ranger from Joshua Tree National Park. But before we get started, I want to share a special shout out to Mr. Edwards' grade 5 class in Fort McLeod, Alberta, Canada. Hello, and welcome Mrs. Hardesty's class. We know you're joining in from near Kansas City, Missouri. Mr. Jonas, your class in Michigan is tuning in. Hello, hello. And Kennedy Elementary School in Massachusetts in the United States, welcome. We are so glad that you all are tuning in classrooms and homes and communities around the world to learn with us today. I want to also start by sharing a tiny bit about Flipgrid. If you're brand new to Flipgrid, please know we are a free video discussion platform from Microsoft, and we are on a mission to empower every person on the planet to share their voice and respect the diverse voices of others. That's also why we're so excited about today's event. Joshua Tree National Park is located in Southern California, and today Simone is going to be teaching us all about desert adaptations. So, Simone, unmute your mic. We're ready for you to join us. Without further ado, everybody, here she is.
All right. Well, thank you, Anne. Hopefully everyone can hear me okay. Excellent. I see a thumbs up from Anne. Oh, and I'm live. Yes, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. My name is Ranger Simone, and I am in a beautiful, sunny Joshua Tree National Park. We've got a blue sky day, no clouds. It's about 65 degrees Fahrenheit where I am. So like Anne mentioned, I am in Southern California. I know we had a few Canadian people. So if you're not sure, California is sort of here on the West Coast, and Joshua Tree is way down here at the bottom of the state. I'm going to pull up just a map of California now. So Joshua Tree National Park is this green blob down here, and you might notice other green specks on this map. Those are other national park sites. So national parks are across the whole country here in the U.S., and they're represented by the arrowhead. So they're represented by this symbol right here. So maybe you have seen this symbol before. Maybe you've heard of our first national park, Yellowstone. So you can make a little Y with your hand, shake it back and forth if you've heard of Yellowstone before. Or here in California, Yosemite. So those are some of our bigger national park sites, like the Grand Canyon, Grand Teton, Everglades way down in Florida, Acadia up in Maine. So they're across the whole country. And this symbol represents preservation and protection. So we protect and preserve our landscapes. That's what our mountain represents. We protect our wild animals. So the animals are wild. That means they can go wherever they want. We have a big sequoia tree in our symbol. So we protect the plants. So we never crush or cut down any of the trees in a national park. We have our body of water here, which is our clean air and clean water. And lastly, the overall shape of the symbol, the arrowhead itself, represents the past that we protect and remember the different cultures and stories from long ago. So that's just really, really quick about our arrowhead symbol. And all the park rangers across the U.S. wear the same uniform as me. We have this symbol on our shirt. So we're going to bring it back to Joshua Tree now. We are a desert national park. So if you have the chat capabilities, or a teacher has a chat capabilities, if you want to put in the chat, what do you think about when you hear the word desert? What first comes to mind when you're like, oh, I hear the word desert. What do I think about? If you want to talk amongst your class, you're welcome to do that. Talk to your neighbor, talk to a parent if you're at home. And if you can put those in the chat, and maybe Anne can help me out and read those chats out loud to me. What are students saying about the desert?
Oh my gosh, we have great questions already coming in. I think I'm excited to to hold off on them and hear a bit more from you. But everybody, use that chat feature, Simone. Those questions are already coming in.
Oh, awesome. Okay. So hopefully when you were talking amongst your students or talking together, what you're thinking about were desert characteristics. So deserts are very dry, sandy places. So yeah, if you said dry and sandy, awesome job, thumbs up. The ground I'm standing on is very dry, sandy, and rocky here in our Southern California deserts. If you were thinking, not a lot of rainfall. So anywhere in the world that gets less than 10 inches of rain a year is considered a desert. So less than 10 inches of rain, not much rain. And lastly, extreme temperatures. So if you were thinking hot, that represents a desert. Excellent. But deserts can also be cold places. So hot and cold, I think of them as extremes. And even just during the middle of the day, it can be very hot in the daytime and very cold at nighttime. So nice job if you thought of kind of those three narrow characteristics of a desert. Our Joshua tree and some of the animals that live in our deserts, and how do they survive in those characteristics? So if we think about a Joshua tree, and I've got that tree is a Joshua tree behind me. I also have a picture of one up close here. It's got these green kind of spines for leaves. Maybe you have a plant around your house that looks like this, or maybe you don't have any plants that look like this. So these long spines here are the leaves, and when they die, they fold back and protect the trunk. So these are all the dead leaves of the Joshua tree, acting like natural sunscreen for the plant. And the leaf shape is really unique as well. So the leaf is kind of shaped like a gutter or a funnel or a slide. So if you want to join me, you can make the leaf shape with your hands. Put your pinkies together kind of like this and your elbows together and hold it up to your body just like this. And we're creating the nice shape of a Joshua tree leaf. So now when it rains in the desert, this Joshua tree is already acting like a slide. So those raindrops are coming down, rolling down my arm and hitting me in my body or the trunk if I was a tree. So the Joshua tree is soaking up all that rainwater from its leaf and storing it in its trunk. So it's trying many ways to store water. That's a big adaptation of desert plants, is to store water and animals as well. So the Joshua tree leaf collects those raindrops before they hit the ground, stores them in their trunk, and they can also soak up rainwater from the roots, like a lot of trees that do that, to soak up rainwater from their roots. So storing water in the inside of a Joshua tree is kind of fibrous. It's not really a solid inside. It kind of feels like the bristles of a toothbrush. This one's kind of firm, but Joshua trees, when they're storing that water, they kind of feel like a sponge, kind of squishy when they're living. All right, I want to make sure we have enough time to walk around our desert to look at some of our plants. Maybe we'll spot some wildlife as we're walking around. So what I'm going to do is just take my device with me, and I'm going to turn the camera around so you're going to act like you're going on a little hike with me. So hopefully I don't lose you. And we're going to see our Joshua tree up close. Here is that rocky, sandy soil I was talking about. We probably had a little bit of rain yesterday, but it's still very dry. We haven't had much rain this year. Okay, here is that Joshua tree that was behind me. And these are those dead leaves folding back, protecting the trunk. And you might be thinking, what do these feel like? They're still spiky. They're still very rough. A lot of our desert plants are pokey. They're not very soft. And that's for protection, right? They're trying to protect themselves from being eaten by other animals. And I'm going to tank the camera up. Hopefully I don't blind anyone. We're going to look at our living Joshua tree leaves up here. So those long green spines are the living leaves, and they're folding back and protecting the trunk. And you see that action right there. This is a pretty tall Joshua tree, maybe about 10 feet tall. I haven't measured it yet. But way down here is our little baby Joshua tree. There we go. And maybe if you're 10 or 15 years old already, that's probably how old this little tree is. They're super slow growers. So Joshua trees and other desert plants don't grow very fast because they don't have all that water you might get in sort of more wet environments. So here's that leaf shape, kind of like that slide. And when it rains, those water drops are rolling down into the Joshua tree and storing in their trunk. This is a little one, a few inches off the ground. And we'll just keep on letting it grow nice and slow. Okay, I already spot an animal here, very quiet. Maybe you can see it. A lot of our desert animals are camouflaged. Maybe you can make the letter C with your hand if you know that word, camouflage. I bet there's a lot of C's. Camouflage means they blend into the environment. So our desert quail here, our gambler's quail, they kind of have a nice light gray color. The quail has a really small beak. So if we look at a bird's beak, that's like its mouth, that helps determine what it might eat. So quail having a little tiny beak, pinching her fingers just like this, would eat smaller food. Maybe we'll see some more birds today and look at their beak to determine what they might eat. We're gonna continue on our hike, our journey here. Gotta look closely and carefully for all of our camouflaged animals hiding here in the desert. This one's being really calm and still. This is a young jackrabbit. Look at its big ears, helping release heat to keep it cool. So that's another adaptation of our desert animals, especially our jackrabbits. They can release heat from their ears to stay cool, especially in those hot summer months. Jackrabbit's also sort of that grayish color, that tan brown, to camouflage, blend into the environment, to hide from predators. So maybe you can think as a class, what do you think might hunt a jackrabbit? What other animal might hunt a jackrabbit? I'll let you think about that for a second. Our jackrabbits can hop up to 90 consecutive times. That's a lot of hopping to get away from those predators you're thinking about. Oh man, this is an unusual animal to spot here, hiding in our juniper tree. Maybe you can guess what this is with your class. Give you a 3 second guesses here. Okay, or put it in the chat if you think you know what it is. You can put the guess in the chat. This is a desert bighorn sheep. So if you say bighorn sheep, nice job, thumbs up. A lot of people get this confused with mountain goat or mountain sheep, but our desert bighorn sheep, characterized by those two big horns curling off the side there. If you feel your fingernails or even feel your hair, you have a mineral in your body called keratin. And that's what makes up the bighorn sheep horns, is keratin. So if you want to have a feeling or have a sense of feeling of what those horns feel like, you can just feel your fingernails. Bighorn sheep are also great at balancing. They have hooves for feet to help them be great rock climbers, balance on our large boulders we have at Joshua Tree National Park. And also, they're super, that C word again, camouflage. They blend into those rock formations super well and are very, very hard to spot. You can maybe challenge yourself later today by balancing like a bighorn and standing on legs. See how long you can balance. And our bighorn sheep are really, really great balancers and rock hoppers. All right. So, of course, we can't forget about visiting a cactus. We're in the desert. So, if you thought about cactus as a desert plant, I've got a cactus right next to me here. This is our more common cactus. This is a choya cactus. I don't poke anyone. And it's got sort of a lighter color. Ooh, and in this cactus, there happens to be a bird. This is our cactus wren. Cactus wren, it builds its nest in the choya cactus. So it builds its nest right inside this cactus to protect its eggs from being eaten. So we can think about our cactus being a really spiky plant, and that is for protection. And it doesn't want to be eaten by other plants. So it's adapted to have hundreds of spines to protect its nice green juicy stalk, which would be storing water. Right? All of our plant and animals need food, water, space to survive, just like us people. If we think about our desert plants, we can kind of look out across the landscape here. A lot of them are more light in color. Maybe they look really dry, brown, and dead right now. Being that nice light color helps reflect sunlight. It actually helps the plants stay cooler. And the sort of dead look is dormancy. So that means they are sleeping this time of year. They're starting to shut down, conserve energy, and not produce a lot of green leaves through the winter season. Another bird. Wow, we've seen all sorts of birds today. Quail to cactus wren too. You might know this bird, a roadrunner. A roadrunner has that really long, we saw our quail earlier, had a shorter beak. Our roadrunner has that really long beak for eating bigger animals, or bigger food, like lizards, young rattlesnakes, scorpions, and even mice. I've even seen a roadrunner with a mouse in its beak. So having that bigger beak helps the roadrunner eat bigger food compared to the quail. The roadrunner has that nice long tail, acts like a steering wheel to help it make those super sharp turns. And one of my favorite parts about a roadrunner is its track. It's what it leaves in the sand, right? Animals leave tracks in the sand. We leave tracks in the sand when we go on a hike. And a roadrunner makes a nice X. So you can always tell when you've seen a roadrunner track by its X-shaped track. All right, so we're gonna continue our hike. Of course, deserts are known for reptiles. We haven't even spotted a reptile yet, but here is another cactus. Of course, we can't forget about our cactus here in the desert. This is a hedgehog cactus. Nice light spines reflecting that sunlight, staying cool, protection. However, there's another type of cactus, a beaver tail. It doesn't have those long spines that we saw in our choya or our hedgehog. Instead, it's got tiny little like baby micro spines, which are all those little dots. So if you see those little dots, those are kind of like small little spines in the cactus. So it looks nice and soft, but really we still don't want to touch this plant because those spines are really hard to get out. And I do spot a reptile being really quiet over here. So I'm going to carefully walk over. Spot one of our unique desert reptiles, and that is a desert tortoise, my favorite animal. The tortoise shell is also made of keratin, so that same stuff that's in a bighorn sheep horn and in our fingernails and our hair. And the tortoise is one of the best adapted animals to the desert by storing water in its bladder for over a year. It can go almost an entire year without drinking water. That is a really long time. We should be drinking water every day to be nice and healthy. Our tortoise, though, are great at adapting and surviving in these desert conditions. And they get a lot of their water from the food they eat. So I bet you can guess what the tortoise might eat. Right here, this nice cactus, they might chew on some cactus. They also love wildflowers. Desert tortoises come out of their burrows. It's a hole in the ground made by an animal in the springtime, because in the spring, that is when a lot of our flowers begin to bloom and when a lot of our dry looking plants begin to leaf out and flower. All right, I'm coming down from our hike now. And here's that blue sky day, as mentioning. It's just so gorgeous today. And I spot one more very furry animal. You can make the first letter of this animal with your hand. Give you a hint, we've already made this letter today. It is the letter C for coyote. It's nice and furry, again, camouflage, blending into the environment and hunting our jackrabbits and eating really anything. They are scavengers, so they'll pretty much eat anything. But coyotes are really common to hear right at sunrise and sunset. And we call that crepuscular. So maybe you've heard that word before. But crepuscular means an animal is active right as the sun is going down or right as the sun is rising. So that's another really common adaptation our animals have, is hunting when it's not so hot in the sky or cold. So coyotes, crepuscular animals like a lot of other animals we have here in the desert. All right, we've been on a short hike today, but I'm going to throw it back to Anne and help answer some questions.
Oh my gosh, Simone, it was so awesome to go on that desert hike with you. And we have had so many people dropping in their questions, which we're going to get to in just a minute, but folks saying hello. So we want to also just say thank you, Mrs. Stein's class at Ella Baker Elementary in Redmond, Washington. Thank you for tuning in. Raja Masawi's classroom in Tunisia. Jasith T is watching. Miss Karen, Miss Natalie, staying up late to watch in Bangkok. Mrs. Jones and Mrs. Snyder, your first Flipgrid Live event. Thank you for joining us. And Mrs. Morgan's class, we are so excited to know you've been studying adaptations. So we're glad you're here to learn from Joshua Tree National Park today. So, Simone, before we get to all of those questions, let's take a selfie with you. So, folks who are listening in, classrooms, families, this is your chance to get set up. Stand in front of your screens and your TV, your computer, your projection in your classroom. We'd love for you to snap a selfie with Simone. And of course, share it with us on social. So go ahead and get set up, take those pictures. Simone's gonna be smiling and tag Joshua Tree NP at Joshua Tree NPS when you share it on social, and be sure to tag Flipgrid too. All right, Simone, keep smiling. Folks are gonna take that selfie with you. This is the time, friends. Go ahead and take those pictures. Does look like a beautiful day in Joshua Tree, California, that sunny blue sky. Yeah. Awesome, Simone. So friends, remember, when you share these pictures on social, please be sure to tag at Joshua Tree NPS, and of course, please tag Flipgrid too. Now, Simone, we have questions for you. Are you ready for these?
All right, let's hear them.
Okay, Eaton School, a fifth grade classroom, is curious, what is the oldest living thing in Joshua Tree National Park?
That's a great question. So a lot of our plants are really hard to age to determine how old they are. I guess living things, some of our animals, like our desert tortoise, can live up to 100 years old, which is amazing. Our Joshua trees can live 100 to 300-ish years old, maybe a little older. But again, like I was saying, they're hard. Plants are hard to age because you can tell in this Joshua tree, there's no tree rings. So we can't count tree rings like we would on an oak tree or a pine tree to help determine the age. So we kind of sometimes use height to help us determine how old a Joshua tree is. Other plants, though, our guesses to determine how old they are. Some of our cactus, we don't know really how old they can be. Our creosote plant, which is a really, really common scrub plant, can live thousands of years old. So our plants are difficult to determine that exact age, but we do have very old plants here in the desert.
Oh, and that's definitely interesting insight to be able to age them, especially some of those Joshua trees that are so tall. Wow, thank you. We have a question from Lagaya, who wants to know how humans could survive in the desert for a long period of time.
That's another great question. So again, remember, as people, we need food, water, shelter, space to move around. So the desert plants also provide food. So some of our palm trees, they provide dates, like maybe you've had a date before. It's kind of a sweet taste. Some of our kind of shrubbier plants, like the buckwheat, provide the flower. Another really common tree, the mesquite, the honey mesquite tree, also provides a bean pod. You can grind up those bean pods to create this flour. So we can get food from the different plants that grow in the desert. Water, especially now with a lot of urban development, so development in the desert, it's tough to find water on the surface to like see water. But a lot of water is underground. So a lot of the plants, animals, trees that grow here, they can get water on deep underground. But there are also natural oases where people can get water. And to survive, shelter, so building homes in natural oases were very common in the past. And rock shelters, so kind of all of our big rocky boulders and outcrops kind of use those as shelter as well.
Oh my gosh, great insights on how to survive in the desert. Now, we're getting a lot of questions about life in the desert, and this is great because today's Flipgrid topic of the day is called Granite Desk Rain Shadow, and we'll show you that in just a moment. But before we do, Simone, can you let folks know what to expect when they use the Joshua Tree National Park Discovery Library page? All right, Simone, can you hear me?
All right. Yeah,
perfect.
Choppy, but I think I got it. So
I can restate it. Could you just tell us what folks can expect when they use your Discovery Library page with all of those Joshua Tree National Park topics?
When you visit our Discovery Library page, each topic does have a place where teachers can sign their individual class up for a live virtual field trip to Joshua Tree National Park, kind of similar to this one, but a little bit longer. But also those topics include lessons about geology, different little videos about our rangers that work here in the National Park Service. So we kind of spotlight some other ranger jobs here and a general park service topic. And we also have a few topics about what is a desert and how plants and animals can survive here. So they kind of range from focusing on the Park Service to geology to desert adaptations.
Oh my gosh.
And again,
so
all of
many.
Those teachers can sign up to book a field trip.
So cool. There are so many great resources, Simone. Thank you. So educators, parents listening in, let me show you how easy it is to find this Flipgrid topic of the day so that your students can reflect on all that they have learned during today's live event. It's as easy as launching your browser and typing in aka.ms/rainshadow. This will take you directly to today's topic of the day, Granite Desk Rain Shadow. And you'll see an incredible video resource that you and your community can watch, and of course, a discussion prompt that your students can use to share and reflect on what they've learned during today's event. You also notice that small blue button that says Add Topic. This is how you can choose to add a topic to a group, create a new group, or even save it for later. And remember to think of a group as your classroom. So here is what your students will see as they begin to reflect on that topic. They can submit their own video responses and share their learning. And of course, they can get creative and have fun using all of those effects and expressions inside the Flipgrid camera. If you haven't seen them yet, be sure to check them out. And even check out the new stickers that we've added. Friends, remember you can use this in your classroom immediately following today's live event. You can use it as an activity or a follow-up to share their reflections. We'll post the link in the chat for you to find it quickly and easily. And now, Simone, let's get back to some more of those questions. Are you ready? Okay.
Yeah.
We have a class in Batavia, Illinois, curious, and I know lots of folks, those animals that you were showing, were they real?
They're not real. Those animals are some examples of what we have here in the desert. Remember our arrowhead symbol, the bison, the animal, we protect our wildlife. So we would never get that close to any of our animals. So there are some examples of what you might see here in a desert. But remember, when you visit a national park, make sure to keep your distance from wildlife and never feed or pet any of the animals because they're wild. They can go wherever they want.
Yeah, that's an important reminder and a way that we can protect and preserve those species as well. Now, we have a student, Henry, who is watching, as well as some others. Why is it called a Joshua tree? And you mentioned how long they could live, but do you notice or why they're called a Joshua tree?
Yeah, so the name Josh trees had many names over the years. The Kuya people had a different name for the Joshua tree. It's been called yucca tree. Scientists call the Josh tree yucca brevifolia. That's the name that everywhere in the world scientists will know it as. But the name Joshua came from pioneers and settlers moving west. So coming from the central Utah-ish area of the United States, seeing these weird trees and named it kind of after a character in a Bible, so a biblical reference to the name Joshua. But it's had many names over the years, and today the more common name is Joshua tree.
Very insightful, thank you. Now, ICS Bangkok is watching, and Mrs. Yaz's fourth grade students are curious, are there any invasive species in the park, or maybe animals that have been added that weren't originally there?
Yes, so our dry kind of golden grass you see all behind me is all invasive. So the tiny shrub grass, brown grass, these grasses are not naturally here. They are invasive species or weedy type plants. Animals, that is a good question. I don't think we have any invasive animals that have actually been brought here to Joshua Tree National Park, but our biggest invasive is definitely these grasses and mustards. We get these huge mustard plants if it's a very wet year, and they are not native to this area. So unfortunately, those grasses do potentially cause fire, so that is an issue. A threat to our Joshua trees is the threat of wildfire because of these invasive grasses that are not naturally supposed to be here.
Oh my gosh, that's interesting. Now, Simone, we have a student, Alex, and actually Ms. Bruno's class is curious, what made you want to become a park ranger?
I became a ranger first as a volunteer. I love working outside. I did a lot of environmental education, so worked with students in the outside environment. And I moved to Joshua Tree for one of my hobbies is rock climbing. And I started volunteering with the Park Service. So I started as a volunteer and then continued my volunteer time interning and eventually became a full-time ranger here at Joshua Tree. But I do love working outside and teaching students about the desert environment, about this unique landscape. We don't really see this Mojave Desert in other parts of the world, and it's so special and intricate. So I really love teaching about our desert landscape.
Oh my gosh. Well, we've all noticed it's a beautiful day there. You said it's a little bit cool, but Eaton School students are curious, how hot can it get there in the national park?
Joshua Tree it can get very hot. We are not Death Valley hot though. So Death Valley is sort of our sister park to the north. And Death Valley is also in the Mojave Desert, right? Mojave Desert's a pretty big area. And so here at Joshua Tree National Park, we have a lot of different elevation ranges. So our headquarters is in 29 Palms, which is a much lower elevation where I am today here at Black Rock Campground. So where I am right in this spot, it can probably get to maybe 110, the hottest, really, hot 112. But over in 29, it can be, get much hotter to maybe even 120 on some of our hottest days. And Death Valley can also get very, very hot. Another national park to our north. But yes, it can get pretty, pretty hot here. But in the wintertime, it can also be very cold. So remember those extreme temperatures. So where I am standing today, I have done these virtual field trips in the snow. So extreme heat in the summertime and very cold freezing temperatures in the winter.
Oh my gosh, what a beautifully vast place. And if folks ever get to visit there, I know they will discover the magic of Joshua Tree National Park. Simone, I cannot thank you enough for sharing your expertise with us. Do you have any final thoughts you want to share with everyone who's watching?
Well, thank you again for visiting Joshua Tree virtually this beautiful morning. I do want to encourage you to go outside sometime today, find a nature park, maybe your local, look up your local national park or preserve or wild space and see which one is close to you. And maybe you'll get to visit one of those natural protected spaces. So I do want to encourage you to go outside, enjoy the beautiful landscape you have around your homes.
I love that advice, Simone. Yes, around your homes, around your school, the natural environments, notice and wonder what surrounds you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for sharing with us today and bringing us all to Joshua Tree National Park. And friends, we are here every week with Flipgrid Live Events, and we have an incredible lineup for you and would love to have you join us for another event. On Tuesday, we will be welcoming Chelsea Clinton and three authors from the She Persisted chapter book series. They will be teaching us how to bring real stories to life. You can head to aka.ms/flipgridliveevents for more information and to register for upcoming events. And don't forget to check out the topic of the day that's live on the Joshua Tree National Park Discovery Library page. Friends, thank you for tuning in. Simone, thank you so much. We hope you all have a great day, everybody. Bye.